What is the proper ideal? That you may be more sensitive to the needs of your fellow man. That you may be more sensitive to the lack of spiritual virtues within yourself, not the other fellow. That you may the more closely hew to the line of that which your conscience dictates through the power and the regeneration of the spirit that comes as a result of meditation. Now, what is meditation? But according to the readings, we distinguish it from prayer in that prayer is a mental activity on your part wherein you speak to God. And we know there are many types, petitionary, intercessory, prayers of thankfulness, prayers for guidance, and so on. But in meditation, you remain still so that God, the higher self, divine within you, may speak with you. This is the difference. Now, when I say a stillness, this doesn't mean you make your mind a blank, but it is a waiting activity. The best analogy that I can think of is when your telephone rings, you answer it and say, hello, you know someone is on the other end of the wire, and you're waiting. It is a focusing of all of the attributes of your mind and your body to the divine within. The readings tell us that these senses that we are so aware of are in reality the mind of the soul expressing through the physical body. Now in meditation, therefore, we can understand how we must still all of the senses of the physical body and mind so that all the powers may be focused on the soul, on the higher self within. So stillness, and this is the most difficult thing, when you begin, you will find that you have a dozen reasons why it isn't necessary for you to meditate, or why today, let's say that 12 o'clock is the day that you have set, the time that you have set, because he indicates it should be in the beginning, the same time every day, the same place, the same chair if possible. All of these things are necessary to prepare your subconscious that you mean business. Now, as you go on in your ability to control this thinking, these things are not necessary. But at the beginning, they are, to show yourself that you are serious, because there are three keys that are very necessary to the awakening of these doors. First of all, or the opening of these doors, first of all, sincerity. This unlocks the door between you and your higher self. And enthusiasm. You must have this emotional quality, harnessed, directed, but it's energy. Did you ever know anyone who really was a marvelous individual to know who didn't have a lot of oomph? So you have to put oomph into your meditations. This should be a glorious opportunity. You should look forward to it, a meeting with your Creator. It should be so important to you that, like tithing, those 15 minutes a day that you will start with should be taken from the top of your 24 hours, not if you've got it left over. It should be that important to you. And then persistence. Now, some enter very easily into meditation. The reason, the readings say, because you have worked at it in other lifetimes. If it's difficult for you, it's because you have not worked at it, or you have not learned to control the mind. Throughout the Bible, we hear, be still and know that I am God. So with these three openings, or these three bits of knowledge to begin your meditation, you must have the preparation also of the physical, as well as the mental and the spiritual. The mental, the spiritual is the right purpose. The physical is the right time for you. What is the best time? The one that you will keep, he says. If you're a real strong, rugged individual, 2 a.m. is excellent. But I don't think we're that rugged. So the one that you can keep every day. Physically, the body should be clean. Now, if you like your meditation at night when your chores are all over and you don't have to get up, then you'll have your shower naturally before you go to bed. Or if you do it in the morning, your body will certainly still be clean. So the surroundings should be clean, the body should be clean, he says. And mentally, the mind should be clean. Do not, the Bible says, approach the altar of God if you have aught against your brother. If you are not speaking to your mother, your brother, your sister, your neighbor, or somebody, make amends, or try to make amends first, before you go to God for help. Cleanse your consciousness. Ask for forgiveness of anything that you know that you are guilty of. Ask for strength to live up to what you do know is right. Not what I know is right, not what some book says is right, but what you feel to be right. This is all that the Holy Spirit expects of you, to live up to your standards. But these standards will be improved and will be cleansed and will be stiffened as you go on, but only as you can take it. So these are the basic preparations. Now, how is it that this functions in the body? The readings suggest that the endocrine system, which really in just the last 10, 15 years has been truly discovered by medical science, the importance of the endocrine system, of the hormone balance in the body, which from that marvelous book written by Dr. Schindler has been proven to be the source of, shall we say, equilibrium mentally, physically, and spiritually within the human being. That to the degree that we could bring forth the greatest number of hormones in the body, to that degree would we be balanced, would we be content, would we be happy individuals. But how is this brought about? He says through proper thinking, through proper living, through living up to your conscience, and this in a great degree is correct. But the readings say, and as Paul has said, the spirit, our spirit, is so willing. Every one of us wants to be better than we are, but oh, this flesh of ours is so weak. And what is the answer? Meditation, he says. It is in meditation that we contact the storehouse of energy that lies within us, the Christ power. Jesus said, I have bread ye know not of. It says he went in the strength of that meat for many days. What was the strength of that meat? This contact with the higher source within, and each one of us has this. This is that hidden manna. This is that table spread before him that David talked about, within us, which we can eat of every single day. This is a part of the Holy Communion, the partaking of his blood, his Christ spirit, and his flesh, which lies within us. So with these ideals, with these preparations, and with this knowledge of these seven centers, but as we analyze so many of these things, we find that there has been kept alive for us through symbols, through stories, this indication of the tree of life within us, the seven spiritual centers. Now, I'm going to deal with them not from a medical point of view today, but from what the readings tell us happens as we begin to meditate, and why this awakens this sensitivity, if our purpose is right, and why we will remain balanced and will grow mentally, physically, and spiritually. As we begin to pray and meditate, we will find that perhaps one of the first things that we become aware of, and this is very common among groups that begin this work, is the feeling of a vibration. Now, what do we mean of a vibration? The only way I can analyze it is very much the same feeling that you get when you take a hold of these handlebars and some of these, not sideshows, what do they call them, carnivals. The electric power that you feel, you begin to feel this flowing through your body. The very first one may be the sound. Remember that many times you even hear the opening of these centers. They emit different sounds. The first that you will hear naturally will be that in the area of the gonads, or the organs of reproduction, the sex glands. It sounds like a great motor beginning to churn, and you feel a turning, and you hear the sound as this power, this great creative power, which we call the sex force, within the body begins to lift itself from this level. Now, the readings tell us that at this area of the gonads lies this great creative power. On the negative side, when used entirely on the sex level, it brings destruction to the human being. On a karmic pattern, it brings, say the readings, tuberculosis and epilepsy when misused. Now, on the positive side, as this force is lifted for other purposes and not used entirely on the sex level, we find that it brings asceticism. This is the seat of immaculate conception, which I wish I had time to go into, because the readings explain exactly how this happens. It is not contrary to natural law at all, but is a law that we have forgotten about, because we are truly spiritual beings. This force, when lifted, brings creativity into the life of this individual. This force creates great music, great poetry, like Khalil Gibran's, great art of all types, Da Vinci, Rembrandt. This art in turn inspires you and me. For me, all good art is that which inspires, that which is good within you. The same force lifted to these other levels makes you kinder, makes you more patient, makes you a gentle individual. This is that same sex force lifted. This is the answer the readings say to the problem of sex. Certainly this is the drive of most Americans today. Does he say to negate it? Does he say to close the door to it? Not at all. So this too would be wrong. But teach the young people that this is the holy force from God. Redirect it, and it will no longer be a problem. Know its purpose, its holiness, and there will then be the proper control. Now let us go to the next gland, the Leiden, about which very little is known. Gray's Anatomy speaks about it as the cells of Leidig. The readings tell us that this is the seat of the soul. Now, please don't ask me what I mean by the seat of the soul. He says the soul extends from the Leiden to the pineal. But this is the seat of the soul, the open door between the higher self and the lower self. As we begin with an ideal, then, this door opens. The soul is beginning its journey back to the Father. Now, this center in itself, on the negative side, is where we have doubt and fear and confusion and loneliness. Why? Because this, on the negative level, is the occasion when the soul has not yet begun to find its way back to the Father. But on the positive side, he says, as this force begins to rise and cleanse and change the vibrations, this becomes the place of balance for the soul, where the characteristics of both male and female are blended in the individual. We know that the predominant characteristics of a man are his strength, his fearlessness, his courage, his drive, and so on. In the female, they should be the spiritual values. But in the balanced individual, we partake of both, which is what Jesus said. It is also the seat of fertility, say the readings. Now this force moves then to the third center, the emotional center, the adrenals. The word itself means add reins. Of all of the animals in this world, even the hippo, who's far larger than we are, the adrenals are the largest in man, showing what he has done with his emotions. The shape of a cocked hat, if you please. So the word itself means here we must learn to use this force also correctly. On the negative side, we have hate. We have gossip. You know some people who just can't be still. Where does this come from? This energy from here, which hasn't been directed in proper channels. And they've let forth of this energy in continual talking. And unfortunately, not too many of us know so much good, so we have to gossip. As someone said, what else is there to do with gossip but gossip? So we know many other phases of negative emotion. But when this creative force with a true purpose rises and stimulates this center, it brings to us courage, that same energy changed. It brings to us persistence, the ability to stay. If you think that patience doesn't take energy, you just try it sometime with someone who's saying everything wrong against something that you love. It takes tremendous energy. So it changes these two to positive. It changes hate to love. It changes this terrible anger and hot temper to patience and endurance. And on the higher level of psychic sensitivity, it brings this ability for communication with other levels of consciousness, mediumship, psychometry. Now this force rising to the next level, the thymus, which lies behind the heart. The Bible says something rather odd about the heart. It says this is the seat of evil, or it's deceitfully wicked. We always refer to the heart as the seat of love. But how few of us know how to express true love? We don't really know what the meaning of true love is. The readings of Educated define it very succinctly in one word, giving. This doesn't mean just your money. This is the easiest thing in the world to give, especially if you've got plenty of it. But it means giving of your patience, of your time, of your energy, of your love to all whom you meet, of lifting them in consciousness wherever you can. This is the type of giving that love is. And on the negative side, it's jealousy. It's the possessive type of love, the licentious type of love. On the positive side, when this force begins to regenerate this area, you have empathy, you have sympathy, you have compassion. And this is the beginning of love, the operation of love for your fellow man. Now we lift this to the next level, which is the thyroid. Now many of us are able, rather quickly, to lift this force to the area of the thyroid. But this is where we begin to have trouble. We will feel a choking sensation when we go into meditation. We will hear a rusty door trying so hard. You know the type they used to have in those horror stories, a creaking door opening? This is the sound you will hear. And readings tell us that as we hear these sounds, this is, of course, the opening of these centers. But on the other hand, also, it indicates short-circuiting. It isn't a clear field. There's cleansing that needs to be done. Sometimes it will swell up so that you can hardly breathe. Why? Because our will is still, again, the Father's will. We have not yet reached the place where we say and mean, thy will be done. We are so many of us like, St. Augustine, who in his early days prayed, Lord, make me pure, but not now. And sometimes we may not think we do this, but when we complain of our lot, aren't we doing the same thing? We're saying, Lord, make me pure, but not this way, Lord, not this way. So the will is a very important point at which often we stop because we haven't yet reached a place where we are willing to go the whole way. We don't know God well enough to know that He will not demand of us more than we can bear or more than we can give. On the negative side, we have troubles with the thyroid. Exophthalmic goiter, say the readings. Too much self-will, and this becomes a dangerous area. On the positive side, however, when this is changed again into this psychic sensitivity level, there comes clairvoyance, clairaudience, and telepathy. Now we lift this force to the pineal. This, the readings say, is the Christ center within the body. On its positive side, as these forces are raised daily and stimulated daily, we find memory of past lives coming to us. Memory into the past and memory into the future. Prophecy. We find that a contrary, and this is a very interesting thing, man remembers. The readings say the soul never forgets. Man remembers that there has been a day when we didn't have to die, when there was some form of rejuvenation possible. Ponce de Leon sought for it outside of himself, as we always do. The readings say the fountain of youth is the pineal gland. Stimulate it sufficiently, and it will keep you youthful as long as you are willing to serve God. It will keep you regenerating yourself. The divine within will keep this body going for as long as you are needed here. So this is the fountain of youth. And it is here also that this holy marriage takes place that, again, Dr. Lentz spoke about the other day. This is also a part of that holy communion. This is where we have the descent of the Holy Ghost. This is where the marriage between you, the Son, and the Father takes place, the pineal and pituitary gland. As we raise this fire, this kundalini within us, cleansing these centers, stimulating them to greater activity on the Christ side, and it reaches the pineal, there is then the descent of the Holy Ghost, and we have a degree of illumination. And then we can go to the pituitary, the master gland in the body, which is representative of the Father within. And at this center, there come the ability for healing and for teaching, as the Master taught. Here we have, in essence, what the readings tell us is the manner and the way whereby you and I may reach that estate that we once had. Now, perhaps some of you feel that this is too stringent a path for you, that there are too many things that are required of you, too many things that you must give up. It is the path of moderation that is called for. There is nothing in itself that is a natural urge of the body that is evil, but the purpose and the excess that makes it evil. Certainly eating to sustain this physical body and eating properly is not evil, but the opposite, gluttony, this is harmful, mentally, physically, and spiritually. Drinking, is this evil itself? As a matter of fact, Mr. Casey says that a bit of red wine with black bread becomes food for the nerve and the blood, but never, he said, more than 2.5 ounces at one time. The opposite, drunkenness, expression on the sex level for procreation and for the control until such a time when the soul has lifted this power where it does, to a degree, express asceticism, is not sin. But the opposite, adultery, is sin. We can carry these into all fields, even the field of knowledge. Knowledge is good, but when knowledge becomes pride, so often knowledge with pride of knowledge brings forth an unteachable spirit, and an unteachable spirit is limited in that which it can learn. So while I would say not the opposite of every vice is a virtue, I think the opposite of every virtue is possibly a vice. Now let us examine for a moment this field through which we must learn to control and learn to be persistent and learn to understand ourselves and this field of meditation. And this is that organ that we call the brain, which is not the mind, say the readings, but the organ through which the mind of the soul operates. There's quite a conflict unless we understand this mind of ours. Mind, he says, is in control of the will and is constantly in opposition to the will. Now, this sounds rather difficult, but let us give you an example. He says, for instance, that many times we use the desires of the physical body, the mind uses the desires of the physical body as excuses. Now, this is in opposition and also in control, because first we must have an ideal in our mind, and then we must use the will, which is the power of the Holy Spirit within, to fulfill that which we have set our mind to. The mind is the spark of the Creator within us. It is that which differentiates us from other life here on earth. It puts us in a higher level of consciousness than, let's say, the vegetable kingdom or the animal kingdom, which is conscious but not self-conscious. But I even hesitate to say we're self-conscious. We do know we're human beings, but we're aiming at a real type of self-consciousness and then to the cosmic or God consciousness. Now, in the experiences that you will first have, do not be frightened. Some people are frightened because they don't know what to do with the experiences that come to them. I think the main reason, perhaps, is that these vibrations that begin to flow through the body are as a sign of encouragement to you and me that something is happening. The readings say that they are a physical manifestation of the spiritual force that has begun to move in your body. First, this force as of electricity. Then you may feel the vibrations of backward and forward, side to side, and circular. You'll open your eyes at first because you're sure that your body is weaving around. And if you're sitting without back support, it will be in a small way going through these gyrations or motions. You will find that a great force will flow to the head. And unless you are sending it out, seeing it leave the body as a light to bless all who may need this, you may get a terrific headache or feel a terrible band around your head. You may feel your hands becoming very, very heavy. This, say the readings, is a sign of the healing power. You may feel a vortex in your hand, also indicative of healing power. Then on the higher level, you'll find that this changes to heat. Now, all of these you'll notice are different manifestations of this same electrical force. In one statement, the readings say, you can call one aspect of God electricity if you want to. This is that force that flows through you as you become a channel. So you may feel it as heat. You will become so hot that if you happen to be in bed, you just have to throw off all the covers. This is the healing force flowing through you. And this will then change perhaps to light, where your whole body is full of light. You will feel perhaps the movement of this force seemingly going up the spine, because these are the sensitive points of contact with the centers. But it feels like bubbles of air floating up the spine and bursting in a light in the head. And then the whole body within quivering, not out, but outwardly, but inwardly. And then this light, this body of yours, becomes a great ball of light. You just know it as you feel it from within. But the Bible speaks of this. If thine eye is single, thy whole body shall be full of light. And from there we go on to some of the higher experiences of being in the presence of the Father or of the Master. not necessarily seeing them, but the acuteness of their presence is so great that, as one of the saints has put it, you are more certain of this presence than if you saw them with the naked eye. And the transmission, perhaps, of a message or of a force. And perhaps the result of this will be, unfortunately, that it does not last too long, but that it will last. You will walk in a great joy and happiness that you have not known for a long time. You will be lifted in consciousness, and this lifting in consciousness will expand to all levels of your being, because if this meditation and prayer is not practical in your life, leave it alone. It should make you, first of all, a better wife, a better neighbor, a better mother, a better teacher, a better whatever you are. Because these readings insist that every single day you are either adding to life, and when I say life, I mean to the good, to the creativity, to that which is good in the life of someone else, or you're taking from it. It's as simple as that. There is no day that passes that you have not either grown or slipped back. You do not remain on the same level. It constantly takes willpower and service to remain in the presence of God. So there will be then greater service, greater opportunities, first of all. Oh, he gives a beautiful definition for opportunity. You know, there's no such thing as good luck as we speak about it in this world. He says opportunity is the result of ideals held to in the past. Or in a more personal way, he said, it is God's expression of appreciation to you. So if you lack opportunities, don't blame the world or your family or your heredity or something else. Be a man and place it exactly where it belongs. So it will make you a better person in every way, more sensitive to the needs of others, more sensitive to the impurity in yourself. Your mind will expand. Your health will improve. Your energies will improve. What you didn't think possible before, you will find very possible. So it is the fruits of the activity of this prayer and meditation that should be for you the measuring rod as to whether it is good or bad. Unless the meditation or the religion or whatever it is you are following leads to this, you are not being helped. There are two definitions that I have come across in the readings, and I personally don't care too much for definitions, because usually we're accepting somebody else's definition for something, and it means that we're not working at it ourselves. But these two words have, I think, been disputed a great deal. And I have, until I came across these definitions, I never exactly knew what they meant. And one is the word truth. Every church, every religion proclaims it has the truth. When we have this, understand this definition, I think we understand why every church to a degree is right. The definition is truth is that which awakens the divine within you and its purposes with you. Now, to any degree then, or to the degree that the church or the organization or the educational foundation leads you to the divine within so that it may become your teacher, to that degree does it have truth. And the second definition is that of faith. Barnabas who gave that. It was always a little difficult for me to comprehend or to follow. But when we understand it in these terms, that faith is an inner knowledge of God or the creative forces, it makes it very simple. Because we have something to stand on. And to begin our search here for the Holy Grail within, this is what Parsifal was seeking. This is the symbol of the search for the Holy Grail. And he wasn't any different than you and I. We seek everywhere, don't we? We run from one teacher to another, from one book to another, from perhaps one church to another, throughout the centuries, until finally, perhaps exhausted mentally, physically, and spiritually, we come home to our own castle and find the Holy Grail there.